I like mine, Mike. According to my, I've conferred with other people, it is now past 9 o'clock, so we're going to call this budget hearing in order. Now, there seems to be some confusion about what is the function of the budget committee? And I've looked around for various explanations about why does it exist, what does it do, what's its authority? And I found a court decision from Rockingham Superior Court, Justice Andrew Shulman, who sort of succinctly explained what the budget committee is and why it exists. This was part of a decision he made in another matter. And he goes on to say, and happened to deal with the school board in another town, while the school board is charged with managing the school system to the best of its ability and to obtain funds with which to carry out this mandate, and there's a court citation, it is not expert on other budgetary needs of the municipality or on the overall tax burden imposed by all taxing authorities within the municipality. Therefore, despite the active participation of the voters in adopting both the town and school district budgets, there is a risk that the financial autarky, meaning independence from one another, of each taxing authority will overburden the taxpayers. With this in mind, the legislature enacted the Municipal Budget Act, RSA Chapter 32, and allowed municipalities the option of ceding some of the taxing and spending power to the budget committee with, quote, authority analogous to that of a legislative appropriations committee. So that's why the budget committee exists. We are the ones which determine the budget. Governmental units propose them to the budget committee, and the budget committee decides what the budgets will be. And with that in mind, and understanding why we're here and who we are, what we're having now is an open hearing on, first, the school district's proposed budget. And for that, I will turn it over to this guy who's talking behind me, Alan, and we should go through a brief explanation of the budget.
I like the school's money.
I like my
question. Now, let me pull up a presentation here for us. There's a little button I'm going to click somewhere. That's right. Thank you.
So, I did not look up RSAs or any laws to talk about today. So I don't have anything from that aspect of it. But I do want to talk about the Rollinsford Budget Committee's school district proposed budget. And so this is my second time presenting this budget. I did it once. Forgive me once again, I don't know all the laws, but I did it at another meeting, the budget committee. And we had some good questions, some good dialogue, and I'm hoping to do the same today. So let's jump right in with our charts. So, I'm not going to drive everybody crazy trying to see this chart, but what I want to show are trends. And I think there's a couple of important things to notice. And the first one I want to show you is this blue line. It's first right here, it's called RGS. And that's for the Rollinsford Grade School, it's where we are today. And if you look at the Rollinsford Grade School budget, so if you look in FY16, we're just over $3 million. For FY17, we came down just under $3 million. And if you look, we continue to decrease to come in around $2.856 million for the proposed FY18. The reason I want to start with that is, one of the things we're going to talk about today is what the school board and the budget committee can actually control from a sense of, from a fiscal responsibility standpoint. There are certain services and contracts that the Rollinsford School Board and the town have put in place. Part of that is what's number two on this list, which is middle and high school. For middle and high school, the town of Rollinsford has voted and approved outsourcing education to the Marshall School District. Well, if you look at the cost of what that's done, we've gone from just under 2 million in FY16 to just over 2 million in FY17. And we're coming up to 2.487, so almost 2.5 million as we propose for FY18. The way we come up with the costs for middle and high school is solely based on the number of students that attend those schools. So we have a fee that we pay per student, it's a contracted fee. And so as the student enrollment in middle and high school increases, that number is going to continue to increase. Whether that's good or bad, we can talk about that as we continue the presentation. The other services down the bottom, those are your SAU expenses, your transportation expenses, your miscellaneous expenses. And you can see that the school board has worked to keep the belt tight. We've gone from 217,000 in FY16 to 205 in FY17, and we did come up this year a little bit to 215, but we're still under the FY16. Right, so with that, we can go into a little bit more detail about what the enrollments look like. This is what we were just talking about. We pay per student for middle and high school, and for the Rollinsford grade school, it's really a sunk cost, right? Because there's a certain amount of money that goes into the building and into the staff to maintain the building. So from a Rollinsford grade school student perspective, the enrollment fluctuations really can be taken without seeing a major increase or decrease in the budget. But when you look at the middle and high school enrollment, that's really where we're going to see some differences when it comes to the values and the fluctuations of the budget. So we can start with Rollinsford grade school. In FY16, we went from 157 up to FY17, where we had 164, and we're projecting 165 for FY18. Right? Now, the projection to 165 is actually based on the average daily enrollment, or something similar to that, as of October 1st of this year. So we're seeing a slow but steady increase in students at Rollinsford grade school over the last 3 years, or 2 years as proposed to as shown here. Right. So now we'll go into middle and high school. From FY16 to FY17, we went from 136 to 154. Proposed out for FY18 is 161. Now, that 161 has three built-in students, so we're calling it a buffer. The reason being, when we went in to FY17, we didn't have a buffer. And we saw, from 136 to 154, right? So when you look at that, and you see 19 additional students, we didn't budget for that. That's $190,000 plus or minus dollars that we can factor into the budget. So because we're seeing an increase every year of students moving into town, the budget committee and the school board both discussed and agreed to add the three additional buffer students into the equation. So with that, let's talk about Rollinsford grade school. So we're proposing a budget for the Rollinsford grade school standalone of just over $3 million. The FY17 budget was 3.37, right? So you're gonna see a change of $305,796 decrease. So what we've been doing in the school board and the town really have been working together to decrease the cost of the Rollinsford grade school, because that's truly where the school board has the ability and the authority to manipulate total budget. So now that we've been able to decrease the Rollinsford grade school budget for a second year in a row, which is how we started 2 years ago, we said it was going to be a 3-year project where we were going to see decreases over the course of 3 years. So to start, to just add to the decreases that we're seeing here at Rollinsford grade school, at the beginning of this school year, there was a teacher resignation. The school board charged the administration to not replace that teacher and to be able to get by without having that additional staff. Because of the administration and it's the co-teaching model, and I'm not going to give you specifics because quite frankly I'm not an expert, but how this school has been designed to provide education, the school was able to absorb that one teacher position and not see it grow. So even this year, we were able to decrease again. So you're going to see some, I call it fancy math, I'm just going to be honest with you, right? But the major reductions that you see, utilities of 15,000, that's significant. A lot of that can be charged with the changes in environment, you know, gas and oil prices and different abilities there. But also, over the last couple of years, the school has brought on a facilities manager. And the facility manager has replaced a lot of the lights with the LEDs and the energy efficient light. He's also gone out and been able to get all of the rebates, the PSNH rebates that we all used to get, so they're sourced now. Filled out the paperwork, gone through that process. So even though the light fixture might cost $20 as opposed to a $5 bulb, we were able to get 15 back in rebates. So all of those things make a difference. And when you see a reduction in utilities from one building alone of 15,000, it's fairly significant. To continue on, I'm leaving the top one for last. Transportation of 14,425. So transportation is a fun topic. We discuss it at every school board meeting. We talk about late buses. We talk about different routes. How many buses are going to be? Excuse me. One of the important things to note that we did for this year, coming into this year, was we made it so our students have the correct number of buses to get to school in a safe fashion. Last year we had a lot of, I'll call them shenanigans going on with buses and drop-off points and how students were getting here and how many students at different locations, we're getting on buses, bus swapping. That's not the way to do it. It's not fair to the students. It's really not fair to their education. So coming into this year, we really wanted to make sure that the transportation issues were taken care of. Minus the late bus, I think that we've done that, and we're doing well, and we are seeing an increase in the fees. We do if voted on by the town, and we're going to talk about it today too, we do fund balance transportation. So we did 50,000 last year, 25,000 into the special education fund, and 25,000 into a building. So we can talk about those when we get to the end of this. Last, I do want to talk about the 195,000 decrease from the warrant. So last year we came forward with some warrant articles to bring three-phase power into the building, as well as some asbestos abatement. And the town passed those things. So what the school board has done and what I'm doing as the budget committee representative presenting these budgets is as we decrease the Rollinsford grade school budget, what we're asking the town is through warrant articles to help us maintain the school. So today, at the end of financial talk, we're going to talk about some warrant articles that the school board would like to see passed. That will help maintain and bring the building up to the standards that we'd like it to see. So the idea is we don't want to put a giant bond out where we do a $4 million renovation to the building. What we'd like to do is continue to decrease the operating costs of the school and see us use warrant articles as a way to do major repairs or major changes to the school that we need to continue education. So with that, I'm going to put the microphone down, change the slide, and take a drink. Excuse me. So for middle and high school, I don't get to have as much fun exploring because we have a contract. And it's pretty straightforward. Number of students times the cost. And forgive me. It's right about $10,000. Excuse me. So, the proposed budget for FY18, $7,335,000. The middle school budget, $547,000. The high school budget, $1,713,000.
Excuse me, this is terrible.
All right, to the point is there's an increase of $354,000. So let's just go back for a second. RGS had a decrease of 305. That's where the school board can make a difference and really look at numbers and really look at processes and look at staff and look at levels and look at the budget. Middle and high school, we don't have a say, right? It's all based on how many students live in town. We can't kick students out. We also can't bring them out. But we see an increase of
$354,000. Now, that being said, there's a $30,000 contingency there because we did build in three. Excuse me. We did build in three student buffer.
Ah, look at that. She is a lifesaver. Thank you so much.
Excuse me. It's the weather changes, huh? We go from 50 to 13 this morning. It's crazy. And I do the Winter Warrior Challenge, so 5 miles a day every morning at 4 o'clock. It's not good for your throat. All right. So here's our total slide. Our proposed FY18 budget, 5.5 million. FY17 budget is 5.5 million. But there's an increase. That increase is $48,000. From the last two slides, the last three slides, I hope everybody saw that we were able to save $300,000 at the Rollins for grade school. We saw an increase of $350,000 at the contractor expenses for the Rollins grade school. Okay, so here's our next slide. Kind of a fun slide. So we're looking at an increase of approximately $92,000 more than FY17. And why is that? Because we just talked about it, there's only a $50,000 difference there. It has to do with all the formulas and how much money and revenue we take in and all kinds of fancy stuff that goes on with the warrant articles and all the things. But the idea is, the budget is coming in at $48,447 per year, or 0.88% higher than FY17. But when you put everything together, at the end of the day, add in the revenues, the savings at the Rollinsford Grade School, and you put back in all the numbers, and bring them together, and you come to our last number. And that's estimated FY18 net budget, which is approximately minus 91.91%, or $445,000 less than that. So even though we saw a significant increase in student enrollment, where we contracted out and we pay $10,000 per student, the Rollinsford Grade School School Board, the administration, was able to keep the budget basically this for the second year. And I think that's significant. Just real quick, every time we do these presentations, we get asked what our enrollments are, what our projections are. Projections are pretty straightforward. It's what we had on October 1, and then for middle and high school, we added three additional students. So I don't need to talk about them. They're all up here. Here's our tuition number. It's worth $10,000 per student. So, before we talk about the collective bargaining agreement, I'm going to have them think about this thing. Thank you very much. And we're going to talk about the collective bargaining agreement, the warrant article number 6. Back in action. Hopefully we're going to make this one last. Okay. Collective bargaining agreement. So let's look first what everybody's eyes are glued to, and that's the net cost increase of $21,615. So yes, if this warrant article passes, next year we'll see an increase of $21,615. And here's why I'm jumping on this table, if I could. I wouldn't pass out for coffee. Why I want the town to pass this. Because the school board was able to negotiate with the collective bargaining, folks, a change in the healthcare costs, a change in how healthcare is managed at the school. So by changing the plan structure, we're gonna see a savings in the first year of $42,000. So to get into some fancy talk for just a minute, that there hasn't been a collective bargaining agreement in how many years? 2 years. So what happens during that time are members of the collective bargaining agreement who are on a step system, so every year they go up a step, and if they change their education, they increase their education, they change the track, so steps and tracks. If there's no collective bargaining agreement passed, those members don't get those step and track changes. Now that's significant, because if a new teacher is hired, they get put on the step and track when they belong. So if a teacher had been here 2 years ago, had a change in education, say you went out and got a master's degree, or maybe added sufficient years credits to already master's degree, they wouldn't change on the track. They also didn't get their yearly increase because there was no collective bargaining agreement. As soon as you put forward a collective bargaining agreement that goes to the town, those things take effect. So that's hard to absorb when you haven't done it. The school board and the collective bargaining agreement were able to negotiate a claim. I'm not going to get into the crazy details, but you guys are welcome to come to the school board meetings or wherever and ask questions about how we were able to do this. But that savings, that $42,000 a year, yeah, we're only going to show it on this slide one time. But the idea is that $42,000 is going to be saved for the future. Right, so that is a savings that will continue to go. Now, if we had a think tank downtown, like they do down in D.C., we would be able to show, this is going to save us $300,000 over the next 10 years. I can't do that kind of math. I don't have a think tank to do it. But the idea is it's a significant savings, and it's a great opportunity for the town because it is going to be long-term savings. All that being said, we are giving some increases, right? So we are going to give the paraprofessionals at 35 cents. But there's no across-the-board salary increases for the teachers. Right? That's all part of the negotiation factors when you're going to add the step and track. So that's really what I wanted to talk about on this slide. So we have a couple of other warrant articles we'd like to go forward with. This has to do with maintaining the building, like we talked about earlier. So as we decrease the cost of operating Rollinsford Grade School, we want to increase the warrant articles so we can maintain it. Article 7, the automatic lift. So out front here, there's a rather large lift that required to be fixed. It required it to be phased out, which we now have. And we can put in. So we're requesting it for $45,500. Place that. That's an ADA compliancy, so especially next to lift that would be wheelchair or some structure downstairs. It's one of the great things about having a really old building, you know, multiple floors and all kinds of action rooms, but you have to have lifts to help with the board elevator. I don't see that. Article 8, electrical. $80,000. This will complete the three-phase power construction. This is great. The shade was up. You can see all the nice transformer and the power that's coming into the building. We have it in two areas of the building. This will put it in the last section. This means that all of the new electronics that come out can be plugged in. It means that we don't have to worry about overloading the circuits. Prior to doing all this, we were told on a couple of instances that we had one more extension cord away from the floor. So that's just kind of a joke, but the idea is that a building of this size is nice to have a few things. It's also a long-term investment in the building, because if we were able to utilize this building for something else, right? So there was talk in the past of maybe making a police station, fire station, community center. All different ideas that I passed around.
three-phase power she used for those types of things. So it was something that the school board went forward with, so that way, you know, no matter what happens with the building, as long as we're not going to tear it down, it's the best way to sustain it. Articles 9 and 10, these are those capital reserve funds that we're talking about. So, so we have two funds, the special education fund and the funds we're not calling. The idea is, at the end of the year, if there's any money left over, we call it the fund balance. That money, if passed by the town, up to $50,000 per each account, can be put into these accounts. So last year it passed, and we had $50,000 at the end of the year, so we were able to move that. These funds are not slush funds or any funds that are easy for the school board to go get. It requires a vote by the town. But the idea is, there are instances of special needs cases that can cost upwards of over $100,000, $200,000 a year. It's hard to eat that when you're running budgets that are as tight as ours. So what we're asking the town to do is have this fund set aside. So if we end up in an instance like that, we can go to the town and say, we have this situation. Can we use this money in next year for a claim? Almost done. The capital reserve fund, that's what I keep calling building funds, the capital reserve fund. That's for if there's a catastrophic event in the building. Not covered by insurance. Even if it is covered by insurance, if we have a COVID. And we've exhausted all other funds, so we've frozen the budget, we've spent all the money we have. We can go to the town and say, the roof has fallen off the building, and we need a roof. Can we spend $100,000, $200,000 in this fund so we can put the roof back? So it's that type of thing, but it would require a vote. So with that, I have my comments and questions. However, I'm going to do that because I can have a drink and make it easy for me. So no comments, no questions? I don't know. You run the show. You got your mic?
The comments should come from the general public first. And someone needs... Are you going to make it?
I'm fine. Sorry.
You want a cigarette? Okay. Before the budget committee makes any discussion, we really would like to hear from the general public. And if you would like to make comments, please approach this microphone here. Make sure it's on. Tell us your name, where you live in Rollinsford, and then whatever you want to say, okay? Anybody got anything to say? And your name, young lady, is?
I'm Lorraine Hansen from 11 Watson Lane, Rollinsford. I just think that the school board should be commended for working so hard to prepare a budget that is meeting the needs of the town of Rollinsford and all of the students. I can't see how we can do anything but commend them.
Come right up. Stand in line if you really need to.
Paul Kazol from Heritage Drive. Okay, I'd like to thank the school board also. Great job on preparing the budget. Did a lot of work. My question is on Article 8. I'm trying to decide in my mind, all for it or not. And I guess I got a lot of questions. If I heard you right, Alan, Article 8 is independent from Article 7. I think you said that we have polyphase power, so in one half the building, so that we can put in the lift, which is a three-phase motor, a polyphase motor. So I don't really know why Article 8 is needed at this present time. As you probably know, electronic equipment doesn't need three-phase power. And also, with the improvements in the lighting, LED lighting, I would assume that the building is using less electricity. But, I could be totally wrong.
Do you want me to engage in discussion and wait to the end? I'd love to answer questions like that.
If you don't hog up half a room doing that, okay?
Thank you.
Right. Trying not to talk about half a room.
Article 7 and 8 are independent of each other. The lift is going to go forward whether or not 8 passes. So it's independent. We need the lift. So hopefully that goes through. Three-phase power is part of the multi-year maintenance program that we're doing here in the school. Last year, we were able to get three-phase power in the front of the building, which is going to allow us to put in that gate up there in the building. Am I right on this, administration?
Yes.
I did that, so. So, we can do the lift without having the additional electric. The additional electrical, like I said, is part of the maintenance program. As we decrease the expenses at once for grade school, we want to increase what the opportunities are, the things that we can continue to do. Three-phase power is something that we put forward. This is the third time it's on as a warning. Came from once to bring it into the building, twice to bring it into the building. So once was to get it to the building. Once was in the building to the main part of the building. And this last one is to put it in the annex part of the building, right? So the idea is we want to have three-phase power throughout the whole building. I'm not going to get into a dialogue about what our use is and where we are in the meters and whether or not it's required or not required. What I'm saying is we have a very good group of people who are volunteering their time. Right? We've gone through an entire list of where it's important for us to maintain and add value to the school and the savings that we have from the operating budget, and this is what we'd like to present to the town.
Okay, still don't understand how is the three-phase power going to be used in the second half of the building.
So I'm going to say, I'm not an electrician, I'm also not an expert, but I am going to say that the experts came to me and told me that this was one of their highest priorities. So I'm putting some trust in that, right? Now I did sit through the presentations, forgive me, I don't have all my notes, but at the school board meetings we did talk about what those things would be. And so I invite you to come back to a school board meeting where we can have the proper support staff in place, where we can talk about what all those things are. And I understand your position, but at this time I can't go into those details.
The cost per student still seems to kind of be going up, and our budget goes down, and as the student population goes up, I would venture to think that our cost per student would go down, especially with the budget going down and the students going up. I know a lot of it's tied to special education, but I guess if we divorce that, it still seems like it goes up. The raises for the teachers, I commend them for their efforts in the school. I know that over the last few years we have not increased the track and levels, but I thought that in the past that they were still getting those even though the across the board raise wasn't there, so maybe that's a misunderstanding on my part. I find it interesting too though that there is no standard raise for them, but other admin and administration folks are still proposing a 2% or 4% raise, but I'm not sure what the town is doing for their raises. And then just a quick question on the discussion on the leftover balances, and is that being applied to certain things, or what that has been applied to from what was left over or perceived to be left over in the past?
sixth grade students. We think about sending those to Marshwood. There's a social piece of that. I'm not sure when the Marshwood, Elliott, and South Borough folks come together. It seems that at $10,000 a student going to Marshwood, that might be something to consider. Not to say I want to have the kids leave Rollinsford, but when you look at the social aspects, my kids came here to Rollinsford, went to summer tour. There is a key social piece for the students going to a different school system and showing up at the same time as other students. That benefits us from a dollar perspective. I just really want to look at it to say, does it benefit the student itself? And the last one really is reducing the teacher. Is that really a benefit to our students and the student teacher ratio for our students in the future? I'm all for paying the dollar for our students. I want to make sure that the right ratio is there for them so that the standardized testing and their preparation for going on is the best that we can make from a town perspective.
Thank you. Sounds good. I took notes. Please correct me or help me if I forgot something. But let's start with cost per student. So, one of the reasons I break the budget out and present it like this is because of the cost per student. It's unfortunate how the state has decided to calculate the cost per student. And so last year we did a very large presentation on cost per student because your observations are correct when you look at the state website. So what I'd like to propose, because I can't talk to you, is what I can tell you is it doesn't factor in that we're outsourcing our middle and high school and that all of our SAU costs and all of our transportation costs are factored into what that cost per student is for loans for grade school students, right? So the fact that we're paying for high, middle and high school, but I can't associate it to their bill, right, means that as we're increasing our bill at Marshwood, we're increasing those services, we're increasing SAU costs, not much, but there was an increase, right? The cost per student continues to rise. It's the way the state calculates. So at the end of the day, what I would like, and what we did last year, was we took what it costs to run loans for grade school, we came up with a cost per student. So Judy actually has it. And
so we can.
So I'm going to give you these numbers. What I'd like to do is offer you at a school board meeting to get deep into the numbers. Because what happens is you factor out all extenuating expenses, right, that really should be split over all the students. So you take out the SAU cost, you take out the transportation cost, and those things. And you come up with the Rollinsford grade school budget, which is what we're proposing here. You divide it by the number of students. So we've actually gone from an FY16 19,005 to FY17 of 17,900. And what we're proposing for FY17, based on 165 students, is 17,300. So a decrease of 3.5%. But that's funny math, right? And that's why I'd offer it at a school board meeting to get in why those numbers mean something and why the state's numbers don't. The state's numbers are to compare districts to districts and for state dollars, state aid, and state things, not for what we're talking about today. Right? Now, average cost per student in middle and high school went from 14,144 in FY16, down to 13,700 in FY17, and that had to do with our transition year. To FY18, it's actually gone up to 15,448. And so that being said, what you're reading on the state website is 100% correct. That's how the state does it, and what you're seeing is correct. What I'm trying to show you are actuals and what we're trying to do about it, even though I can't change those numbers. Okay, for raises, you kind of alluded to the fact that the step and track increases are not received on your additional budget. Just steps, no tracks. Forgive me, I misspoke though. I misspoke. And the reason is, we have teachers who would have jumped tracks. And they weren't able to jump. So in my head,
I was thinking step and track. Forgive me for that. I apologize. They do receive the steps. I should just.
You understand?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You brought up different noises. I don't remember what the town's doing. I think it's 2%. Which is what the majority of the staff. So we didn't do that with the teachers because it would be unions, with the bargaining unit, because we were able to negotiate an agreement that we believe both the bargaining unit and the school board that is in the best interest of both groups and the town. So I don't want to get into why there's no raise there. It has to do with what we've decided to do. The 2% for the staff at the school that's not covered under the agreement is in line with the town, and I think in line with what is happening. There is one staff member at the administrative level that is at 4%, and I would say that that's our administrator here at the school. And to reduce your budget by $300,000 2 years in a row, I think 4% is a very reasonable number to give a meter of that. So a couple of points on why leadership is important and why 4% is deserved. First, we've been able to reduce the budget by $600,000 over 2 years. That's significant, 4% is close to that. Second, the Rollinsford Grade School is one of the pilot schools for the PACE initiative, which is a new way to evaluate education. And that is done, honestly, because of the leadership from our administration in the school. So the quality of education has not changed, even though we were able to reduce a teacher, we're able to restructure how classes are conducted here at the school. All that's done from leadership, and it started with a task that the school board gave the administration to figure out how to do it for less. And the only way to save money, I didn't show up the crazy charts this year about the Rollinsford Grade School contracted services, how much it costs to just run utilities, just to open the door, and then you factor in what it costs for the staff and the educators, right? And then you factor in what it costs for the special education. So the co-teaching model is implemented, and you've seen 2 years in a row, you've seen the reductions that have occurred. So that's why we are, I would say, doing our best for the school. But this is a good time to talk about sixth grade, so I'd just like to do that. I'm going to jump into this a little bit. That's really a school board discussion, not a budget discussion. I will say, though, that nothing is off the table. Right? And that's what, one of the things when you start looking at budgets like we are, is we don't throw away any ideas. We keep them coming, and we keep looking at things, and with the end result, to lower the cost of running the Rollinsford Grade School and maintaining or improving the quality of education. So sixth grade is definitely something to talk about. The leftover balances. So we call it fund balance, and not fund leftover. But last year, we felt, due to constraints in special education in different areas, that we were actually going to run out of money. So we put a freeze on all expenses. And this went on from about April, nothing before about April. So what ended up happening was we got our final bills, and we were not as bad off as we had projected. Right? A lot of that is in special education. So we've put some things in place so that doesn't happen again, because that's important. Right? So we have some things that we have in place, so hopefully we don't experience that. But we were able to use the fund balance to do the things that we had put off doing because we thought we needed more money. So the school board has, within its authority, some ability to spend money. You can't, it's not like at home at the end of the year, it's December 31st, and you've got an extra $500. You're like, oh, if I don't spend it, I gotta give it back. And so it's not quite that. From the legal aspect of it, we can spend the money within our budget, within our means, and we've done it. whatever's left, we start with the fund balances. Then there's a contingency that the school can hold over 7%, 2%, some contingency, forgive me, I don't know the percentage, that the school can hold for 1 year for any emergency that comes up. At the end of that year, if that money hasn't been spent, which is a process to spend, I mean, it would be a cash drive to spend, it does go back to the bank. And so, the idea is the fund balance we like to put into the two capital reserve funds so that way we have it if we need it without having to go to the town. So without those fund balances, if we had a scenario where we had a special needs student or students moving to town with a very high expense, right? So we ended up with a $500,000 expense and the school couldn't absorb that. You saw the budget numbers, there's no $500,000. We could go to that fund if that fund exists. If it doesn't, we would go to the town and we'd ask for more money. Right? So what we're trying to do is just build up that and account for it. And same with the capital reserve fund. There may come a time when the capital reserve fund has enough money in it, where instead of coming out with warrant articles to raise money, we use it as more of a capital improvement fund, where we come to the town and we say, oh, actually, we have these things that we can use because it's a whole legal aspect of how you use it. And we move forward with that. So that's really the funds. I should have talked about the student-teacher ratio. That's another school board item. But the idea is that the co-teaching model and the leadership that the school has, right, they've been able to change the philosophy of education here at Oxford Grade School so we can decrease the budget and continue to improve or maintain the quality of education. So I don't believe that anyone would argue that the quality of education has changed since we lost that teaching community. But that's where I stand. Did I hit everything? Thank you.
Average student cost in Rollinsford, fly back.
Better mic.
When we talk about average student cost and state figures, we're comparing apples to apples. We're not selectively taking out expenses to make us look better. We're talking about what does it cost for an average student here in Rollinsford versus Somersworth versus Marlow, New Hampshire, or some other town. That gives us comparability, okay? And the 15-16 numbers are as follows. The state average was 15,033. The Rollinsford rate for the prior year was 19,524, or $4,500 more than the state average, okay? Student-teacher ratios, the state average, they now break it up in grades 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, across the board. Rollinsford has three fewer children per teacher than the state average. So it's a much lighter load. The $300,000 that is down in the elementary school budget, a good part of that came from these maintenance items that were part of the budget. The three-phase power last year for $125,000, the asbestos removal and floor replacement for $70,000. We're not going to do that every year. The other part of it was transportation. It's down because they don't have a kindergarten midday bus run. So that reduced it by $17,000. A lot of this so-called change is things that will never occur again. So they're not really savings. They're just, they happened, now they don't. We're not gonna do an argument. Okay? The cost of students at Marshwood is a fixed cost. It is a contracted service. But we need to start comparing apples to apples. Stop being creative with our accounting. Taking out certain things that, you know, we think shouldn't be part of the equation. They are part of the equation. We have to pay the SAU cost. We have to pay the fixed cost to run this building. That's life, and every other school district in the state does. That's all I got to say for now.
He's not going to get away with all of that. He's not wrong when it comes to comparing the state costs, right? And I was trying to be very open and honest, very transparent, and I gave my presentation that the state has numbers, and those numbers are actuals, and we're welcome to use them. What I've provided the town are actual dollars that I'm asking the town to raise so we can run Rollins for grade school. Those dollars can be divided by the number of students, and you're getting the Allen Robinson average cost per student, which I think adds value to a taxpayer trying to figure out where the school is going. Are we increasing costs? Are we decreasing costs? Are we increasing quality of education? Are we decreasing quality of education? I can't tell you that we should bring in 3 more students per classroom. I can't go outside and find them and drag them in so we can meet the state average, right? What I can tell you is if we reduce one class with 15 kids in it, that's a lot of kids that go to the other classes. The only problem is they're all in the same class. So I need 5 classes to handle those 3 additional students, right? So Vern is 100% correct in everything he just said. Everything he said is right. What I'm trying to show are how those numbers can make sense to us. And I'll be quiet.
Yes. Your name is?
Caroline Lamoureux of 20 Silver Lane in Rollinsburg. I'm going to start with my original point, the reason I stepped up here, which was to express my awe and appreciation for the level of ingenuity and creativity in what we are seeing this morning, both in our volunteers who are elected in that capacity, as well as the staff who supported them and originated what turned into what we're seeing. And for that reason, I want to express my support for the budget, but particularly for the raise to the administrator, who is clearly illustrating creativity, but also an ability to manage an evolving pedagogy for which we are receiving recognition at a state level. And that's important, and I think that as residents, we should be proud of that, and I'm hoping that the Budget Committee, as you deliberate after this public hearing, the purpose of which is to hear what we feel, less so how I think the Budget Committee feels, because that you will deliberate about that, and I'm hoping that you will be here this morning to listen to us and hear the people, and I, for that reason, I want to tell you that I support this, and I hope that you, as a Budget Committee, will support it also, and in so doing, support our volunteers who have tirelessly put together such a professional and clearly creative solution to what is really an ongoing desire and goal and well-done effort to reduce the overall budget, because we are, of course, all bearing that burden. I just want to close by saying I think that your state average per student cost, while correct, is an oversimplification of the problems or challenges here at this school and are part of the maintenance problems that this board has made tremendous efforts to address. And I applaud that and I appreciate it and I hope you all do too. Thank you.
Mr. Jansen.
Good morning. My name is Ed Jansen. Some of you know me from the past. I've been a taxpayer for since 69, whatever the number of years I've had, so quite a while. I was on the budget committee. Well, I first got on the budget committee when I was on the school board back in the early 70s. After frustration on the school board for 4 years, I gave that up and worked with the fund. So I appreciate the problems that the school board has. I offer my thanks for their efforts. Part of what this school board presents resolve of failures on the part of our legislature and so forth in the past to make clear the kind of information they ought to provide for us. The first criticism I have of what's presented to us today is I go back to my old, one of my peers in this town many years ago, Dan Matthews. And when I was on the budget committee and selectmen and so forth, the first question he would always ask, Ed, what's that going to do to my tax rate next year? And there's not enough people asking what is happening to tax rate. But giving kudos to the school board and others for nice manipulation of numbers, or to get good staff that know how to manipulate numbers. I looked at the budget, and there's so much stuff in there that it'd be followed to my insight to really find out exactly what's going on, what is it, what are the appropriate comparisons to make and so forth. But first of all, this is not a budget. You call it a budget, you call it a budget committee, but a budget is got revenue and expenditure proposals. And I don't see that when you look at revenues, it's always very simple. Whatever we don't get from outside revenues, so for taxpayers will pay for it. So it's been that way. I've always been a critic for 40 years. Question is, I don't know about some of these things that they don't look at the capacity to pay for it. It's high. And when you look at this community, the problem you have here, of course, and I've said this before to many of you critics, many of you don't want to hear it from, because that's another problem with this kind of community. Almost all these people, and most of them are my friends, used to accept and say, oh, yeah. But really, if this doesn't address the revenue issue size, how are we going to pay for this? How are the old guys that's 83 years old, that's been retired for a dozen years, is going to eat up all the savings by paying taxes? What's the biggest check I write in this town? The biggest check I write to let my household or anything else is checks to the town of Rollinsburg for my property taxes. It's $7,000 every 6 months. It's $14,000 that I have to take out of my retirement. And you know what, I don't get a 2% increase this year. You know, 0.3% was good. People on Social Security. I go down to the bank and look at what they're expecting to get. They give me 0.4 on some of the banks. So 1% seems like a lot of increase. I would like to have 1% increase in my income this year, but I don't. So I have a negative rate of increase in my capacity to pay, but they keep raising up and and we've done a pretty good job, but as Brandon said, and when you compare our cost of this school small tax base. Well, you got 165 students or whatever in the school projector. And that is a very small number compared back to the days when I was on the school board in the early 70s. And so they've held the line, but the numbers over the years have gone down or held fairly stable. And what we're looking at the future, and you can ask Sue what's happening to the revenue outside sources that the town's getting. What I was involved in a negotiation 40 years ago, or approximately 40 years ago, on the electric station down here, the hydro plant, which I have been told the revenue has been reduced. And so our outside revenue basis is going down. And that's, at one time, outside revenue on the town side was much more important than the taxes we were paying. Because when we took the revenue sharing and a whole host of other things we had, that disappeared. And so our real problem as a town, when you look at collectively at the county, the town, and the school, is that we don't have the tax base to support what everyone is demanding from us. And each group entity justifies what they're doing, saying it. We've held it this year. And as Vern says, you can manipulate this. I all people, of course, know how you don't really, what you say for this 1 year doesn't mean anything. It's really what you're talking about. Over the next 5 years, what's going to happen. And I want to know, though, for this year, I get to get specific and stop philosophizing about something that most of you don't care about. It's how the older people are going to meet this. And you say, well, it's very simple. Sell your house and get out of town. You bring in a new person. In my house, I had 4 children in the school system when I first came here. Of course, my taxes were $700, I think, total for the first year. Now I'm up over $14,000, so that's why I get a little excited.
I apologize. You're absolutely correct. I have them.
Okay, so that's enough said for now. So, you know, I'm unhappy, and I will remain unhappy. I know we're not going to change all this, but somehow, when you look at what's coming down the pipe with the financial crisis and so forth, Trump tells you that we're going to get a lot more revenue and so forth and jobs, but we have a tremendous debt problem in the world, not just the United States. And we have right now 7 states that are essentially bankrupt. And more every year that's coming along down the pipe. Because the taxpayers have been, our legislators and our representatives on boards at local and other level have been spending more than they've taken in. And then we're borrowing money or white span, different ways you can go about this, but we can't keep on this way. So I hope I'm still around in 3 or 4 years. I may be going tomorrow. But anyhow, I would like to
So I can give you those.
Okay.
And so what I'd like to do is I'm going to go down the list, and then I'm going to give you the bottom line. So to start, Article 5 of the operating budget would see an increase of 0.22. Article 6, which is the collective bargaining agreement, that would be an increase of 0.10. Article 7, which is the lift for help fund for ADA compliance, is 0.2. To add the two-phase power, Article 8 is 0.36. So for the warrant articles, it would be an increase of 0.88. For Article 9, which would be the transfer of the $25,000 to the fund balance for the capital reserve fund, that would not
have anything because of the junction of fund balance. For Article 10, which is the other fund, would be also zero because it would just be a transfer. So estimated tax impact for warrant articles is 0.88. That being said, just like you talked about, sir, was that there was a projected increase in revenues of 0.42, which leaves a estimated tax impact for all warrant articles and increase in revenue of 0.46.
Judy Nelson, 9 Order Claim. I am also a member of the school board, as most of you know. I appreciate Alan's presentation, very nicely done. I also appreciate Mr. Jansen's position and other people in town as well. I just would like to thank folks who seem to have noticed the work that's been done by our administrators, by the school board, and by the teachers union, the Rollinsford Education Association. We have worked very hard, keeping in mind that everyone needs to afford what we're doing here in town. One of the things we sometimes fail to focus on, though, is the value that we are receiving for the price we're paying. We are receiving a very good value here at Rollinsford Grade School and at Marshwood Middle and High School, and as our students end their careers, we will only have seniors next year at Summersworth High School. Education is very, very important, and it is something that we need to look at the value we receive as we go forward, and I believe that we have worked very hard in the last couple of years. The school board made more or less a promise to the town that we would work very diligently to get operating costs down. The only operating costs that we have any control over are here at Rollinsford Grade School. And we have been fortunate to partner with an administration and the Rollinsford Education Association to be able to do that 2 years in a row. So should this budget go forward, as we hope it will, we will show 2 years in a row of significant savings. Thank you.
I'm hoping that if I use my schoolyard voice, you can all hear me, and I won't get anybody else's germs. No, thank you. Thank you. No, thank you. I appreciate it. I just wanted to answer, just for information only, Ed's point about town revenue. And while, in fact, revenue for the hydro fund has been decreasing over the last couple of years, our overall revenue picture is increasing because of building permits, because of DMV, because of some small increases from the state. So you'll hear more about that when the town makes its presentation, but on the town side, revenue has been increasing.
Thank you.
Are there any more public comments that anyone would like to make? Your son wants to testify?
He will not be testifying. My name is Celia Leopold, Ward at 26 Washington Street. I asked the school board this last year, and I would task the budget committee with this. If this is a school meeting and it relates to the parents in this town, would you consider reaching out to somebody to provide childcare so more of the parents can come to this meeting? And then I have a couple of comments too. In regards to the capital reserve funds, some money went into it this year. And how much was already in those funds? How much has been added? And has anybody been withdrawn from those accounts? And if the budget does not pass this year, is there any rate increase from the previous year? I know we default to last year's budget, but would there be any rate increase this year?
Sorry, the rate increase for what?
If we do not pass the budget, is there a thing?
Thank you.
The budget doesn't truly fail. It's either recommended or adjusted, and then there's the default budget.
I think she's...
Is that what you're looking for, the default budget?
In the town, yeah, the default. So the default budget hasn't been calculated yet. The default budget has not been calculated. We have, there's a lot of things that go into place, and so that'll be on the ballot when it comes out, what the default budget is. Last year, the default budget was actually higher dollar value, right, looking for headline, than what we presented. And I believe this year is going to be the same thing. It won't be because of the increase, at the Marshwood. So either way, we don't have those numbers yet. They'll be on the ballot, though, and you'll see them. We don't have them. So that's for your one question. From the perspective of the town, right? It is what it is, number, when it comes down to what the default budget will be, and it'll be calculated soon. As for the fund balance, the special education fund is at $130,000, and the building fund is at $78,000. And our goal is not to grow these funds to be millions of dollars. The idea is to get a reasonable amount of money, a couple hundred thousand dollars in these accounts that would help the town in a case of an emergency.
Charlie Dion, 44 Rollins Road, and I hate speaking. Okay, I got a couple of points. First, I think a 1% raise is sufficient for the school. Second, I don't think there should be contingencies in the budget for the middle school and high school. And the reason why I say that is because you had a big increase this year and you still got a surplus. Thank God you could be able to do, in December, you voted to do $25,000 out of this year's budget to do the bathrooms, which is great. You've done a great job. Now, my other question is on that. What about the $30,000 for the shed? Is that still in the works or are you going to do it on this year's budget? One question. And then the next thing is the contingency. The reason why I don't think we need contingencies is because we had a big increase this year and there's still a surplus in the year 17. So I don't think you need those two and three students. Thank you.
So I'm great with the recommendations, which are good.
Thank you.
When it comes to the $30,000 for the shed, that as a school board matter, it hasn't come up for vote yet. So that would be something that comes forward.
One quick follow-up. That was in your budget thoughts in September, October.
Okay, so
heard any more about it. I don't know, maybe has it gone by, or are you going to do out of this year's budget? That's the thought.
Yeah, so I think that we're just not at that level of detail yet. It's the truth of the matter. So we're focusing on this. These are the one articles we're going forward with. And you come up the school board now, so I appreciate what you've just added for value. So I would expect to start hearing discussions about that if it's something that the school board is going to be taking on. It won't be me, though. So this is my last couple of months. Right?
Tracy Laurie and Kara Scott. I'm in support of the budget. I just want to remind us that we don't have a choice on special education or something like that. If somebody moves into town and needs something, we have to do that. So if we don't have the contingency, is that what we're calling it? If we don't have that in the special ed, then we have to come to the town. It isn't a choice. If somebody needs something and we don't have it, we have to cover it. It's the law. That there's no choice for it. So being able to have something in that to make sure, that just makes sense. That's good sense. And I just want to repeat, I'm in support. This was a lot of work. They spent a lot of time thinking about this and doing this. Working on keeping the school running and savings to the public, to us taxpayers. I'm very proud of what's been done and watching it happen, so thank you very much.
there anyone else who would like to make any comments regarding the budget? Don't all jump up at once. Okay. Oh, Kim, you want to do a quick? Oh, yes.
Was really the word articles and the resignation of a teacher. And it was hard for me to see, and it's not clear to me even now, what they have done this year to reduce operating costs. So if you could talk more about that.
Yeah, so you're not wrong. I mean, we talked about the math in the beginning, but there's a significant amount, 195,000 that came off the tutoring articles last year, the 7,000. The teacher that resigned this year, the administrative plan was to have that teacher removed for the sorry, I'm just trying to keep my voice from. So when the teacher resigned, the savings that we're seeing from that, the school board tasked the administration not to fill that position, but that was done with the anticipation of we were going to come forward minus a teacher in the budget that I'm proposing tonight. So that's when we started this process, it's a 3-year process. So we were coming forward with 3 years worth of budgets that were going to show decreases in. And so we were able to realize those savings faster. So we took advantage of that. To the point just a few seconds ago on the bathroom renovation, that's where things like that can come from. For this year, we had the savings, the 15,000 in utility savings, which are actual savings. And I get that. I get it's not a huge dollar, but it is a dollar problem. And I would hope. So one of the things to keep in mind is every year we come forward and we're decreasing. The way we're presenting the budget, right? We're showing a decrease in the voluntary grade school budget. Right? So warrant articles, a little bit of utilities, a little bit in other factors, the fact that we lost a teacher. At some point, when we come to present a budget, we're not going to be able to show those values, right? So we're going to have to start showing an increase, or maybe not, right? Maybe, but the decreases won't be as dramatic. So we're not trying to be funny math. I mean, unfortunately, as Bert pointed out earlier, there's certain things that the state, when you figure out your budgets, that this is how they do it. I don't like them all either. The savings are just what you see them to be. They're not huge savings this year, right? It's the 3-year plan as we go forward. And then the idea that we've discussed and we've really been working on this 3-year plan that we've talked about is realize the savings in the operating budget and increase the warrant articles. And this year we're coming forward with less in warrant articles than we did last year, right? So we're not quite as high. I don't remember the totals. I see you looking down.
197.
Today, this year is 197?
I think so.
That. Yeah, I was going to say, no, this year's is just the 80 and 45. Oh, yes, you're correct. Yeah, so it was like 195 last year. And then this year, we're bringing on the ballot the 45 and the 80, so 125. So we've reduced it ballpark-ish, you know, $70,000, $80,000. So, it's not. I can't give you fancy numbers and fancy figures and fancy accounting terms. All I can say is we're coming forward with less money in warrant articles. We are coming forward with less money in the operating budget for the Rollinsford Grade School. But we are seeing the increase. That's really all I have. I don't have any additional details.
last chance. Does anybody have any more public comments, including members of the Budget Committee? We do.
Emily Leach, Heritage Drive, and I'm also plaguing. I'd like to address a point that Mr. Jansen made about increasing our tax base, and just note that one way to do that is to get more people into this community, more houses built. As Suzanne mentioned, we've got more building permits, we're having revenues come in from that. People moving into this community increases the tax base, making this lesser overburden for all of us who live here. One way to get people into our community is to have an excellent school. And I think that what we can do at Volunteer Grade School, our move to Marshwood, are both things that are making our town more attractive to families who may consider building a house here. So hopefully, any tax dollars that we add by approving the school budget can be offset by the fact that our town is becoming a more attractive place for families to come and
live. You school board members got to stay away from each other. To be passing out.
Else
to make a comment regarding the school's budget. Going once. Twice. I'm looking around. I'm trying to be attentive.
Okay.
The hearing is therefore
adjourned. We will take
a short recess, and then the Budget Committee will reconvene and consider the school's budget. We're going to take a short recess. Thank you for coming. I appreciate your comments. Thank you for participating. They could be really at 25.
Stronger than I was going to suggest, because it's gotten some municipal association. We can get that right at the start of the makes a real difference. And so it's a really good question, no matter where it came from, but what is the text that shows up on the ballot on the Tuesday vote if the deliberative session makes a change?
That's what I want to know. Exactly what Suzanne said. And it makes a difference for my vote today, and it makes a difference at my vote at the school board meeting in favor.
Proceed with recommending what we recommend. Is that correct?
No.
No.
Now.
No.
Now. I cannot move forward to the vote unless I have the answer to that question.
Good for you,
Ellen. And I feel as though the budget committee is making a decision that has impact to the town without knowing the entire scenario and without having a legal opinion, and I think that that's wrong. I will make that note.
Okay, you make that objection. Are you ready for the vote?
Yes.
Can't believe it.
You're confused.
I am. I'm uncomfortable voting if I don't know what I'm voting for. And if we don't even know if what we vote for today stays or goes, it's ghost.
Okay. What we're voting on is the motion amendment.
Well, I know what we're voting on, but I'm worried about the consequences of what we're voting on if, in fact, we don't know what happens at the next meeting.
What next meeting?
At the deliberative session.
Yes, Kim.
So I believe we can vote on this today, but we need to have a legal opinion prior to the final, post-deliberative session, but prior to the warrant being finalized of that text. I think we should have legal opinion for that.
Bad idea.
I think we need a legal opinion before the deliberative session.
Okay, that's fine. Yeah. So we can still make a vote today of what we recommend.
Alan, are you comfortable with that?
Nope.
If there's a legal opinion before the deliberative session?
No.
So Alan is going to abstain from this vote, and after this meeting, I'm going to look up the formal procedures to challenge this vote.
Are there any other questions, comments, or issues that need to come before this? Let's try the new issues, please.
Just a clarification. This vote, basically, we're saying we're cutting $4,000 or whatever from the bottom line, right?
Yes. That's it. Anything else?
Recommending the new.
Yeah.
Right.
All right. The vote now is, what does the budget committee recommend for the school district budget? And it has been amended from what the school district proposed, reduced it by $4,082. So we're voting on a new budget bottom line. What was proposed less $4,082 or the number that Kim gave us?
Recommend or not. Right?
This is recommend that lower number. You can vote yes or no. Okay. I'll begin with you, Michelle, this time. Your turn.
No.
What?
No.
One, no. Bill?
No.
No. Dennis?
Yes.
Kim?
Yes.
Madeline?
Yes.
Carrie?
Yes.
Suzanne?
No.
You abstain. On the grounds that you're just unclear what the legality is of it?
Okay. Yes.
Nancy? Yes. And the chair says yes. So that is 6 in favor, 3 opposed, and 1 abstention. The budget is reduced by $4,082. Are there any other adjustments, changes, or recommendations for the budget from the budget committee?
We just
recommend. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you want to go on to item 6? Now we're going to, now actually, other more. Okay. Now we're going to consider the warrant articles, which are
warrant Article 7, receive the Rollinsford School District will raise and appropriate the sum of $45,500.
So just point. Let's do six. Let's six.
Oh, sorry. Any thoughts on the collective bargaining agreement? Bill?
Move to accept.
Second.
Okay, it was moved to accept as submitted by Bill, seconded by Michelle.
Is there any discussion on the matter?
Yes.
Bill wants to talk.
Yes. I just think it's very important that we recommend this and move this forward, as I think the long-term implications for healthcare in the town for our employees are grave, and we need to recommend this, and we need to make this happen. Thank you.
Kim.
It would be 42,000.
It is 42.
It's within the budget. It's what's currently in the, it's proposed in the budget.
So just for clarification, it's costing us $63,000 approximately to save $42,000.
Right.
Yes. Difference of 21,615. Now that, can I continue?
I just wanted to say what you said is correct. That premium savings, right, continues, right? So I, this is what I talked about earlier, right? Because we're changing the health insurance, we're only going to be able to show that on one warrant this year. But the idea is, as everybody changes to that in healthcare, we will realize that savings every year, right? So that's all about the 20 points.
So. It's interesting way to phrase, you know, spending $62,000 to save $42,000. But apparently that point is, or the fact of the matter is, that if every teacher not on the appropriate step were to resign, and we were to hire new teachers on those same steps, we would be paying that $62,000 whether we had a new contract or not, because that's what the contract currently states, the existing contract. All, in my understanding, is all what we are doing by this contract is putting the teachers on the step at which they belong. They and it's costing us a bit more because we haven't had a contract for a couple of years. But the in order to get teachers to accept the lower cost health plan, they said, well, hey, you should. The contract now has to pay us what the contract says it's going to pay us, because we are now on this step. So while you're literally correct in how you phrase it, it doesn't really address the fact that new teachers coming in would have to get paid on the appropriate step, and we have current teachers who are on that step, we're not getting paid in that step.
Plus taxes
next year, and year after,
and
year after,
and
year after.
No.
So, well, actually, I have some comments. Because it's more, it's
deeper than that. Because we did, in this particular case, there are some teachers who might have their step. So, to make the difference, we provided a one-time stipend for them. So when you factor in the one-time stipend and the changes at the one-time, one-year stuff, it wouldn't be the total of 52,739. It would be some number minus some other stuff. But your point is, yes, that's we were talking a bit earlier, it's the gift that keeps on giving, right? When you get a salary increase. To Suzanne's point, though, right, if our teachers eventually get fed up with this thing, right, when we hire a new teacher in, we have to put them on that correct track and step. So, yes, well, the teachers are willing to work at the reduced rates today, right? We do experience less costs, but at some point that could change anyway. So, yes, to answer your question, though, the salary increases will continue over the
OAS.
So, oh.
The 1 year.
Yeah, no. So hold on a second. So, not everybody talks the same way, and I believe Kim and I are on the same page. All right? It is a one-year contract, and it's a one-year expense. But when you give someone a step increase, it increases their base salary, which means the following year, their base salary will be what that was. There's no percentage increase to the team. Like, and I say the table, it's a track step team. So are Kim and I, so I'm just going to put everybody else aside. Are you and I on the same page? Okay, I get it. Now, for everybody else, do we confuse anybody, or does anyone want to take that question to you?
As an employer, I mean, what we have to understand is that the budgets are based on the current set of employees. The employees do come and go, and so if a teacher, one of these teachers who is getting hopefully a step increase because of this collective bargaining agreement, if that teacher were to leave, that increase could go away if you hired somebody at a lesser track or lesser step. So, you know, we're only budgeting based on what the current employee pool is, and to say that salary base stays the same or from year to year really depends on your pool of employees, and that's all I said.
So just my final point. You know, we're hearing from people in town concerns about where our taxes are going. I am concerned that our teacher does being in the top 10-15% in the state. That's not good.
Are there any other different comments regarding this warrant article?
Yes.
I just have to say, and it's been said already by Bill, but just to reiterate that if we don't address the health care issue at some point, which we haven't done, we keep saying no, it's not going to get cheaper. And if we can at least vote the contract in so that piece is taken care of, it will save us money in the long run as the cost of health care goes up.
Anything else? I will make a motion to have the budget.
It's just a point of order, right? It's really better for the chair not to make a motion. The motions
okay.
Really should come from.
Can you make a motion, please?
Call the question.
Oh, I'm sorry, I was wrong. I guess the motion has been made. You made the motion. And I got crazed. Yes.
Oh.
So, sorry.
We will now call for a vote. Is that right?
Yes. Well, that's not a motion. You said motion.
I'm sorry. I didn't have enough time either. All right. We are now going to vote on Article 6, which has been placed before the Budget Committee. Do we recommend or not recommend? Can we have a vote? Let's do roll call again. Nancy, your turn.
No.
One no.
Yes.
Alan? Yes. Suzanne?
Yes.
Carrie?
No.
Matt?
No.
Kim? Dennis?
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
And I vote no. So we are tied, unfortunately. Motion fails. There is no recommended. Motion recommend fails because it's tied. So functionally, we do not recommend. Or I wish there was a third choice here. We stand neutral. We don't have that choice. Yes, 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 yes.
Four.
Ten. Okay. A tie, the motion fails, it is not recommended.
Well, it's not recommended. I guess I can say
nothing.
I guess
not recommended. There's no recommended. Well, I don't think that's possible. Yeah, I wish there was a which can you stand neutral on this subject.
So we have an attorney contacted, it might be worth it to have that attorney ask that question as well.
Okay.
Pardon? 5-5.
Vote
no.
Yes, the vote count was 5-5.
No, can you put that on there?
You can't put on the warrant things that are not statutorily obligated to put. That's the kind of this conversation that we had the last time. Now,
can't put down like budget committee was in.
By the way, are you allowed to vote unless there's a tie? Is that part of this? Could that be?
There's no rule.
Dennis, look, I make a recommendation.
You got to speak up.
I can speak up. Next year, we should probably have.
Yeah.
I don't have a voice. I'm losing my voice. Didn't happen until I got here. All right.
Sorry, Dennis. All right. That's a procedural recommendation. Next year, we have an attorney present to give us some guidance.
I'm not going to. We've never done this. I've been here since what, 95?
We've never had a budget committee. Never had a budget committee.
No,
no, I'm talking about
when it comes down to looking at long-term savings and health, looking at what the school board put forward when it comes to a collective bargaining agreement. When you negotiate something, you come to middle ground, right? That's what happens. With this collective bargaining agreement, I'm excited to not be on the school board and budget committee next year because I can't, they should never come forward. You know why? They should quit, get rehired back at the correct step, and keep the health plan they're on, and it's going to bankrupt this town.
That would be complicit in budget committee.
We need an attorney to tell us.
I recommend we don't get the town attorney, we get someone neutral.
Okay, we're going to move on. We're going to move on to Article 7. To see if the Rollinsford School District will raise and appropriate the sum of $45,500 for 188-lift automatic door openers. Just one door opener? 188-lift automatic door openers.
One lift.
Subject for...
That's the lift.
Okay. It's a tight one.
Move to accept.
Second.
Wait a minute. Okay. So we have a motion to accept as submitted. Michelle seconds. Is there any discussion? Michelle.
If I get sick from this mic, you guys are all in trouble.
It's his fault.
Whoever. I just want to say this is an ADA requirement. I don't know that this is something that is negotiable.
Any other comments? I will call the question. We will have a roll call vote. Starting with Michelle.
Yes.
Bill?
Yes.
Dennis?
Yes.
Kim?
Yes. Yes.
Matt? Case? Carrie? Yes. Suzanne?
Yes.
Alan?
Yes.
I would think you said that. Nancy?
Yes.
Okay. And I'll vote yes. So, a yes vote is unanimous yes vote. All right. Moving along. We don't want to be here all day. To see if the Rollinsford School District will raise and appropriate the sum of $80,000 for the purpose of extending electricity to the Rollinsford Grade School annex, that part of the building. We have a motion to accept as submitted.
Motion to accept.
Second.
What?
Suzanne. Okay. Is there any discussion? Michelle.
I'm going to be the bad guy here and say that maybe this is something we can wait one more year for, as long as the lift can function without it, which is what I understood to be, just because of the tax rate. And, you know, I heard Ed Jansen myself also, you know, my first thought was, oh my word, if I retire here and my taxes are $14,000, I can't retire. So I'm just throwing it out there that I would be interested in seeing if this is something we could wait one more year to do.
If this doesn't go, will it affect the day-to-day operation of the school at all for the upcoming year?
First is, can we have new
I mean, there's certain parts of the board that have it, so you can use the classroom, the gym, the building to utilize whatever machine or whatever it is required. That's fine. So, yes, it's not like a lot of as for moving it out to next year, what the school board has done is set and committed over 2 years worth of budgets, which show a reduction in the operating cost of dollars for grade school. And they're going to request that the town increase two more dollars, maintenance to the building. And this decision was made when the school board was looking at bonding to renovate the school. So instead of moving forward with a bond to renovate the school board has come forward with reducing operating costs, using that reduction in savings to go out with more dollars to do this maintenance. The three-phase power is part of that process. So we don't have a capital improvement plan this, where you can see that they're putting money aside or working on a project. What the school board is trying to do is get the school, get the building where it needs to be as we move forward without a huge bond. And so the three-phase power is part of that process. And so, when we talk about putting it off the following year, I get worried about putting anything off because we don't know what is in store for the following. And so, in this particular budget, we are looking at an increase of 0.42 total is our, so total for the school, we're looking at a 0.46 tax impact. What I'd like to say, is I would hope that the changes, the maintenance, and the quality of education that the school board is working to provide is going to do exactly what we talked about in the last week, that it will increase the younger families moving into town, it will increase building permits as they expand and renovate their houses, it will increase the building so the tax base goes up. And as the tax base goes up, we do evaluations of the town, and then when you do the evaluation, all of the houses like Mr. Jensen, who's not doing any major renovations to his house, I'm just that's an assumption based on what he said tonight. His taxes, his actual taxes will go down because all of the other members who are moving into town, right, they put the additions on their house, they've done these different renovations, their taxes go up. And that's the idea behind having a school that's a sought-after school, that's a sought-after education.
She just asked.
I answered her question. I asked to Suzanne.
Yes.
I let you speak it.
Just as a point of information, it's helpful. The budget that the budget committee will be presenting to the public here needs a 0 cent net impact on the taxes.
So when we look at the town as a whole, I think that that's important to know.
As I recall, just to sort of recapitulate, you asked, could you wait a year? Which required, yes, or no.
The question's been answered. Let's move on.
If the question's been answered, I don't need to talk.
Right.
Can we?
Yes.
Dennis.
I don't want
to. Well, we can't hear you.
I'll talk loud.
Good man. Right.
Do we have a building?
Yes.
That we can do.
$78,000
in the
budget.
So
Dennis, we're not hearing you. I'm sorry.
You can't hear me?
No.
Do we have a building fund that we can put money into this?
So,
no.
Yes. Wait.
How much is this going to charge? How much is this going to cost us that it's all said?
No.
So the answer is not what Vern said. It's not yes. The building fund that we have, that we requested the $25,000 has specific rationale and specific legal reasons on why you take money out of it. It has to be an emerging need. So we can't come to the town and say, we want to take out, so we're talking about this of 80,000. So we have 80,000, say, in this account, which we do have in a funding account. But we can't ask for 80,000 to put in for three-phase power. So we can't ask for it. So this particular... We can't ask to take money out of the fund for that type of change. It's not an emergent need. Yeah, correct. Thank you.
All right. I recommend that we do this. Yeah.
Well, I'll my concern is we just saw almost a 40 or 50 cent increase in the school tax impact from this last bill. So we're looking at another 40 plus increase, correct? What? 40 cents. 40 cents per thousand.
We just saw a 40 some odd cent tax increase in this last bill for the school. So we're looking at another 40 cent increase for the school. Correct. That's one point. My other point is this notion of bringing families into the town and raising the revenues doesn't make sense to me. Because when one house's tax bill does not pay for a student, how does that offset? How do you, if it's $10,000 or $20,000 per student in this town, and one house's taxes is maybe $10,000, how does that math work?
Can we call a question?
Yeah, let's just call.
It's been called. Question's been called.
Second.
Question's been called.
Second.
Nancy seconds. We will now have a roll call vote.
Thank you.
On this matter, Nancy, you're first.
Yeah.
Yalen? Suzanne?
Yes.
Carrie?
Yes.
Haglund?
No.
Kim?
No.
Dennis?
Yes.
Bill?
Yes.
Michelle?
Yes.
All right. I'll vote yes. It passes 7-3. Okay. Okay. Article 9, this is the $25,000 to be added to the Educationally Disabled Children's Capital Reserve Fund previously established. And that money will come from the June 30 fund balance of this fiscal year to be put into the next fiscal year, 2018. Because it's coming from essentially surplus funds, it will not add to the tax base.
Tax
rate. Are we clear about
rate.
That?
Tax rate.
Are there any questions? We got to
move to accept.
Bill moves.
Second.
Who seconds? Suzanne.
Let's vote.
Sounds like you want to be
happy.
Are there any questions regarding this matter? Comments? Yes.
Just clarification, Alan, there's $130,000 in that fund now, and there has been no activity to draw from the last 5 years.
Any other questions, comments, issues? I'm going to call the question. Those in favor? Starting with Michelle?
Yes.
Yes.
Bill?
Yes.
Dennis? Kim?
Yes.
Madeline, yes.
Yes.
Carrie, yes.
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 Yes. I'm going to vote no. Article 10, see the Rollinsford School District, this is the $25,000 for Rollinsford School Building Improvement Capital Reserve Fund previously established. Again, from any funds left over at the end of this fiscal year will be put into next fiscal year. Is there a motion to accept as read? Bill?
So moved.
Second.
Who seconds? Nancy? Is there any discussion on this matter since it's very similar to the previous one?
No.
I will call the question. We will roll call vote again. Michelle?
Yes.
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 Madeline, yes.
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 I will vote no. All right, there are no other matters that need to come before this budget meeting at this time. I will entertain a motion to adjourn the deliberative session.
No move.
Bill, motion to adjourn, who seconded? Nancy seconded. We're done at 11:36.